Welcome everyone to the Stanford Responsible Quantum Technology Conference. I'm your host, Maurit Skop, and it touches my heart to see so many colleagues and friends together for our Quantum Physics and Arts-Inspired Law Conference. Thank you to the Stanford Law Dean Jennifer Martinez for having me as a visiting scholar, and to our esteemed faculty, Professor Mark Lemley, who directs the program in Law, Science, and Technology, and who generously sponsored today's event, and to Professor Hank Greeley, who directs the Center for Law and Biosciences. Thank you to Roland Vogel, LSD Executive Director, our wonderful staff, Jody and Giselle, for your support in putting this event together. We had so many folks interested to attend, so it was a challenge to accommodate everyone, which is pretty unexpected since we organized this for the first time, and given the early stage of the field. I have a background in music, law, and technology, and my typical day is filled with academics, policy, and consultancy in both Europe and the United States along transatlantic lines. So I work with universities, governments, IGOs, and industry. This year's theme of the conference is quantum ELSP, and as with any emerging technology like semiconductors, AI, nanotechnology, nuclear, there are interconnected ethical, legal, socio-economic, and policy implications that must be proactively considered. And quantum ELSP started 2 years ago when Luciano Floridi from Oxford University, soon Yale University, asked me to edit a special issue for Springer Nature. And it was so inspiring to work with him. Descriptively, quantum ELSP refers to research focused on the societal aspects of quantum technology. Normatively, quantum ELSP can serve as a meta-paradigm that sets an interdisciplinary research agenda. As such, it can inspire an account and practice of responsible quantum technology. And over the past year, I had the honor to lead a spectacular team of 10 scholars specializing in quantum physics, engineering, law, ethics, data science, and innovation policy. And we found that the potential transformative power and societal impact of second generation quantum technology directly harnessing counterintuitive quantum mechanical effects such as superposition, entanglement, and tunneling urges us to proceed and innovate responsibly. And so we conceptualized RQT. A warm welcome and thank you to our team members, Professors Timo Minsen, Urs Gasser, Glenn Cohen, and Eline de Jong, and I learned so much from you during all our studies. With a round of applause. So this conference discusses how to balance maximizing benefits and mitigating risks of applied quantum technology in computation, sensing, simulation, communication, materials, and quantum classical hybrid approaches in diverse multidisciplinary settings, taking a pro-innovation stance. And today's four goals are, first, bringing the quantum community, you, together in an elegant atmosphere so that we at least know each other when AI takes over. Second, learn from leading companies who are in this room with us today about the state of the art of quantum technology and explore novel new use cases together beyond cybersecurity and data privacy, and of course without inventing problems that just do not exist. I had a training session with ChatGPT, and I asked it to list 250 novel use cases, quantum use cases, and it dreamt up stuff like quantum-empowered tourism. And did it mean time travel? I'm hopeful that we can do some demystification today combined with moonshot thinking. Third, discussing in inclusive intergenerational settings what RQT amounts to and how we can make it happen in practice, building bridges of mutual understanding and trust between disciplines, generations, and cultures, actively steering towards values-based quantum ecosystems and beneficial societal outcomes on the planetary level. And in such an exercise, creativity, imagination, and lateral thinking are pertinent. And I think that we have 50 years, half a century, in between the youngest speaker and the oldest speaker today, but I won't tell you who they are. Fourth, connecting the dots between patents, trade secrets, national and economic safety and security, technical standards, governance, geopolitics, and innovation that should be as open as possible and as closed as necessary. Some housekeeping. We are excited to offer you a series of 10 musical interludes throughout the day, performed by the most talented musicians and opera singers from the music department I could find. And they are so professional and a joy to work with, often doing double masters in music and computer science and physics, young Stanford leaders. You already heard Katie, a four-time U.S. Chopin Foundation Full Scholarship recipient, treating us to Chopin Andante to set a mood. And you'll see that as today's topics get heavier, the music gets darker. And you don't have to be silent when they play. In addition, we have live quantum physics experiments over there by the brilliant Frans and Daniel over in the back. And they built me a quantum computer, especially for today. It's a new photonics-based linear optical qubit design with error correction to the vacuum level without cryogenics. And their demos are about sound and light, about waveforms we hope to be observable, synonymous to the Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics as formulated by Bohr and Heisenberg. During the reception at 5 p.m., there will be an opportunity for you all to connect with them as they will continue to demonstrate their installation then. And the demos crucially connect music to quantum by using sound as a quantum analog. We have timekeepers notify speakers at the two-minute mark with a red sign and showing a stop sign when time is up. And they are very strict as we have a lot of ground to cover, very rich program. And if a speaker or moderator takes questions, please raise your hand, state your name and affiliation when you have the microphone. So we try to compose a program that I hope you will find illuminating in many dimensions. And without further ado, I'd like to introduce our first speaker, Eline de Jong, a rising PhD candidate from Amsterdam. Eline holds three cum laude masters, is on our responsible quantum technology research team, and she will explain to us how society can prepare for the quantum age. Please welcome her, Eline de Jong.
Yes, good morning, everyone. My name is Eline de Jong. I am a scholar from the Netherlands, and it's really an honor to be here today and to start this conference with my presentation about embedding quantum technologies within society. I have this clicker. So I was trained as a philosopher and ethicist, and I first focused on artificial intelligence and then I switched to quantum technologies. And I'm currently a PhD candidate on the philosophy and ethics of quantum safe cryptography at the University of Amsterdam in the Netherlands. And I was invited to share my perspective today on how we can anticipate quantum technologies and embed them within society. In other words, how can we guide the step from quantum technology from lab into society. And in my paper, On the Unknown, an anticipatory approach to for preparing society for the quantum age, I identify five structural challenges that come with quantum technology step from lab into society. And in my paper, I argue that quantum technologies are a system technology in the making. And system technologies are technologies with a systemic impact on society. Embedding quantum technologies or system technologies come with five structural challenges. It requires demystification, contextualization, engagement, regulation, and positioning. And by taking up these challenges proactively, we can anticipate quantum technologies and eventually guide their impact on society. Today, I will first introduce the concept of system technologies and the framework that I co-developed for embedding these technologies within society. I will then apply this framework to quantum technology to explore the kind of challenges that we will face when embedding quantum technologies within society. And I need roughly 15 minutes to do this, and hopefully afterwards we will have time for one or two questions or comments, and else we will have plenty of opportunities today during the coffee breaks. So, the system technology framework. From 2019 to 2021, I worked at the Netherlands Scientific Council for Government Policy, which is the scientific advisory body for the Dutch government and parliament. And there I co-authored a policy advisory report on artificial intelligence. And in this report, we coined the term system technologies to refer to a class of technologies with a systemic impact on society. And by systemic impact, we meant that they impact society broadly, affecting all sectors and all domains, as well as deeply. They change the things we do and how we do them. And we coined this term to highlight this kind of impact. Oh, too quick. And examples of earlier system technologies are, of course, steam engine, electricity, the combustion engine, computer, and artificial intelligence most recently. Now, what can we learn from how we dealt with these technologies in the past for dealing with new system technologies and embedding new system technologies within society? Historically, there are five factors that influence how system technologies find their way into society. The first is perception. How people perceive a technology is decisive for their attitude towards the technology. Second is the social and technical context. There are social and technical factors external to the technology itself that are crucial for its functioning in practice. Third is the societal context. It matters whose stakes and values shape a technology. Fourth are rules, which evidently direct the course that a technology can take. And fifth is the international dynamic. The development of system technologies is always, to a certain extent, an international affair. Now, we can reinterpret these five factors as the five challenges, the five structural challenges that come with embedding new system technologies within society. So it's important that we counter unrealistic perceptions. This is the challenge of demystification. That we create and supporting socio-technical ecosystem. This is the challenge of contextualization. A variety of stakeholders should be involved in the innovation process. This is engagement. We need adequate regulatory frameworks that guide the development and use of system technologies. This is regulation. And the development of system technologies is, to a certain extent, an international affair, so we should strategically position ourselves within an international network. This challenge is positioning. So this is the system technology framework, five structural challenges that guide us in how we can embed these technologies within society. And I think that this framework is a useful way of thinking about the kind of challenges that we will face in a quantum technology step from lab into society. Quantum technologies as a family of technologies shares important features with other system technologies. So in my paper, I argue that quantum technologies can be considered a aggregated system technology in the making. And the most important argument here is that quantum technologies have the potential to affect nearly all domains and sectors in society by offering new capabilities for acquiring, simulating, processing, and transmitting information. And it was this kind of society-wide impact that we called systemic impact. So assuming that quantum technologies have the potential to have this kind of systemic impact, the system technology framework can be a useful way for thinking about how we can guide the leap from lab to society. I also think that there is now a momentum for anticipating quantum technologies and thinking about how we can guide this step. As real-world applications come closer to realization, so are their real-world impacts. And although these applications might take some more time, I think that we should also bear in mind that it takes time to prepare society, and breakthroughs can accelerate innovation in unpredictable ways. I also think that the huge potential of quantum technology appeals to a responsibility to address risks proactively and to use new abilities wisely. And as we are still in this early phase, we have a window of opportunity, because now we can still shape these technologies more effectively than at later stages. So let's see what these five challenges may entail in the context of quantum technologies. The first challenge was demystification, which is about answering the question, what are we actually talking about? New system technologies are always accompanied by mythical ideas. They typically feed into speculation and hype, either overly positive or overly negative. And demystifying a technology is then about countering such unrealistic perceptions. And this is important because unrealistic negative images and unrealistic positive images both come with risks, either in terms of missing out on important opportunities because of a lack of trust, or in terms of irresponsible use because of misplaced trust. So in the case of quantum technology, a potential myth in the making is that of a quantum computer as some kind of magical machine, a general problem solver. And in this image, quantum computers will put all the capacities of classical computers on steroids, overcoming all of the limits that we currently run into with our classical devices. And this image totally overlooks the fundamental differences between quantum computing and classical computing, which makes them suitable for different kind of tasks. And I think that we should be aware of this kind of horseless carriage trap. People describe the first car, as horseless carriages, trying what they did not know, cars, in terms of what they did know, horses and carriages. And although this sometimes helps, we should also be aware of the risk to neglect the distinct newness, the novelty of a new technology. So when it comes to embedding quantum technologies within society, one of the challenges is making this technology intellectually accessible to a larger audience, because grasping what quantum technologies are and what they are capable of is a precondition for successful and responsible use, but also for having a meaningful societal debate. The second challenge is contextualization, which is about the question, how will this work in practice? Whether a technology functions in practice highly depends on the social and technical factors external to the technology itself, so to its socio-technical context. Cars needed roads, electricity needed wires, computers need data, and likewise, for quantum technologies to function in practice, it is key that we expand our attention for the development of these technologies to the development of a supporting socio-technical ecosystem. and Luciano Floridi calls this process enveloping, creating an environment, a socio-technical environment, in which a technology fits and in which it can function well. So the question then is, what kind of socio-technical envelope do quantum technologies require in order to function well in practice? If quantum computers will be brought to end users as a cloud service, for example, they will need a technical context of advanced cloud infrastructure, for example. And when it comes to the social context, quantum technologies may require a specialized workforce or a reorganization of processes and the way we used to work. So this challenge is about organizing the social and technical factors external to quantum technology itself that enable its proper functioning in practice. The third challenge is engagement, which is about the question, who should be involved? Initially, new system technologies align with the interests of those with power. But the broader engagement of people, of a broader group of stakeholders, either in a resistant or in a constructive way, can shape the development and the use of a technology. And this is eventually crucial to the process of embedding it within society. So this challenge is about involving a variety of stakeholders in the development, the implementation, and evaluation of a technology. And this is very important because by democratizing the innovation process in this way, we can attune a technology to society early on. Currently, the development of quantum technology is dominated by male technical experts, and it is driven by a small elite that has the resources to engage in this process. So the choices that are currently being made regarding the architecture or the purposes of quantum technology reflect certain points of view and certain stakes and values. And as such choices are really hard to revise at later stages, it is important to now include different perspectives in the innovation process. So the challenge of embedding quantum technologies will consist partly in opening up the innovation process to a broader group of stakeholders. The fourth challenge was regulation, which is about the question, what kind of frameworks do we need? Defining rules is, of course, an important way to direct, but also to stimulate technological innovation. Safety rules stimulated the use of electricity, and traffic rules stimulated the use of cars. So also, when it comes to quantum technologies, the challenge is to develop adequate regulatory frameworks. And here we face a famous dilemma, the Coleridge dilemma, which you probably know. And it describes that in the early days of a technology, we have a knowledge problem because we do not know what kind of issues will arise by using this technology in practice. And by the time that we do know what these issues are, we have a power problem because it's very hard to change already developed structures and consolidated stakes. So it's our fate that we are either too early or too late when it comes to regulating technologies. So the question then is it too early for regulating quantum technologies? Not exactly, I would say. I think that we can partly address the knowledge problem by initially using more flexible regulatory instruments, like standardization, for example, which can be adjusted more easily to new developments and experience. But I think in addition to this kind of reactive regulation, we can also use regulatory instruments in a more directive or active way to steer the development of technology into a direction that we actually desire. So when it comes to regulating quantum technologies, the challenge is to develop adequate, timely, but also visionary regulation. And the final challenge was about positioning. And this is this centers around the question, how do we relate to others internationally? And as I said before, the development of system technologies is always subject to international dynamics, not only because all the previous challenges have an international dimension, but also because there are issues that specifically arise on the international level, such as national competitiveness and national security. And the challenge of positioning then calls for adopting an international network perspective and thinking about strategic position within that network. Because it's from that position that we can meaningfully shape or co-shape the development of a system technology like quantum technology and have an active role in the process of embedding it within our societies. And I would say that especially in the case of quantum technology, the development and deployment of quantum technologies is an international affair. We're internationally entangled, so to say. I promise that this is the last time that I make this question, that I make this this joke today. So if we want to make effective use of quantum computers, of the quantum internet, it is important that others can do it too. And even if we don't have a quantum computer yet, we should prepare for others to have it. So when it comes to national competitiveness, the frame of a quantum race can be quite misleading, because winning this race will probably entail joining forces and international cooperation, and not just competition between individual nations. And when it comes to security, there are direct risks that come with quantum technology that we should address, but we should also be aware of the more indirect risks, like the more indirect ways to exert power over how these technologies are developed, for example, via international standardization processes. So the challenge of positioning is about adopting an international network perspective and strategically thinking about our position within that network. So to wrap it up, quantum technologies are on the edge of taking the leap from lab to society. With real-world applications come real-world implications. And if we want to equip society to deal with these new implications, we should best approach quantum technologies as a system technology in the making, which is a family of technologies with the potential to impact society systemically. Embedding system technologies into society come with 5 challenges, and by taking up these challenges proactively, we can prepare society for quantum technologies. And I think that we have the responsibility and also the opportunity to do so now. Thank you very much for your attention. And if you have any questions or comments, I think that we have 1 minute left, but we have plenty of time today. Thank you so much. Do we have one question, one pressing question? No? Okay, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Our next talk is also about our quantum LSP collection. It's the Quantum Governance Stack, Model Governance for Quantum Information Technology by Elijah Perrier, who came all the way from Sydney, Australia. Tell you about how he would approach quantum governance. Elijah Perrier.
Thanks for that introduction. Hi, everyone. It's great to be here, and apologies if I'm a little bit spaced out. I took a very late flight. And I woke up at 1 a.m., so I'm sort of in this superposition state of awakened sleep at the moment. So yeah, it's great to be here. A short bio about me. So I am a PhD candidate. I'm almost about to finish my PhD in geometric QML. So I spent a lot of time on the design of quantum algorithms, and the kind of problems I'm trying to solve are: how do we build quantum circuits in an efficient way? So I'll talk a little bit about what quantum is, but we've got some great speakers who will go into some of the more critical details. Oh, let's push that off. I also am a research affiliate at the ANU, and that's where I sort of do work on ethics of AI. And that's actually how I came to this problem. And actually, before jumping into my talk about my paper, I want to give a small bit of context. And for my sins, I work in investment banking, where I do a bit of law as well. And that's interesting because I'm starting to get questions from senior people at the bank about how we should use quantum. So this field is very much at the centre of the Venn diagram of my life. So just prior to going into the paper, the quantum governance stack, I just want to give a little bit of context about why I wrote this paper and what gap I was hoping to fill in this field. Of course, the field is just emerging. Okay. So this paper that I wrote, the quantum governance stack, is, as the title suggests, really about the governance of quantum information technology. And we will hear a little bit more today about what is meant by quantum. It's, you know, it's a broad field. In some sense, everything is quantum. But in some sense, when people talk about quantum, we aren't talking about all things that could be categorized as quantum. What we're talking about often is quantum computation, quantum information processing, and quantum sensing. So this paper I wrote is really about trying to look at how does one go about thinking and providing a taxonomy as to how we start thinking about the governance of quantum computing. In the paper, I introduce what I call the quantum governance stack, and it's a hierarchical actor instrument approach to quantum governance. And I should say the paper is actually really written more for my colleagues in quantum than my colleagues in law. There are several people here who obviously have a deep background in tech governance. And so, you know, as you read this paper, you may say, well, it's just tech governance, you know, sort of 101. But really, I wrote this paper partly to address the fact that in the quantum field, people don't have much of a clue as to what counts as governance. And so I sort of wrote this paper sort of for them in the main. In the paper, I set out a taxonomy of quantum governance, and I try to associate the concept of governance with the concept of risk. And I do this, and I'll talk about this soon, but I do this because, you know, it's really important, and we know this, you know, if you work in the law or we come from tech governance, that we have a lot of law, we have a lot of governance, and we have a lot of deep expertise in how to govern technology. And so for a field such as this, where we're looking at how to overlap how we govern new and emerging quantum technologies, it's really incumbent on us to really understand, well, do we need new governance instruments? What is sui generis about quantum technologies and the governance of them? So I'll be talking about some of these shortly. But I just want to give a little bit more context, and someone will shout if I'm taking too much time. So I came to this problem a couple of years ago from AI ethics, and the problems I was really concerned about them were in the FAIR ML context. So that's the sort of context around, well, you know, if you're building AI systems, how do you make sure that you're complying with, for example, anti-discrimination law? How do you make sure that you are complying with other sorts of ethical constraints? And I was really interested in, well, you know, if you're encoding these constraints in AI, what does it look like? And I'm not going to give a talk about what that looks like in terms of Markov decision processes. But fundamentally, I then started to think, well, what would that look like on a quantum computer? So if I had to encode the types of ethical constraints that we're all concerned about now with the rise of ChatGPT on a quantum computer, what would change? Would anything change? And so that really was part of what drove me to sort of write my first paper on this, which is called the Ethical Quantum Computing. And in that paper, I really, somewhat ambitiously, tried to set out, well, how would you start to think about this field? And I said, well, first things first, you've got to understand, what do we mean by quantum? And so I think it's incumbent on us to really really focused by what the subject is that we're talking about. You know, oftentimes we are talking just about quantum computing, superposition states, quantum entanglement, quantum sensing, and that kind of thing. But that is the first order of business for any field such as this. And then the second kind of questions in that paper I really talked about were, well, once you've understood the tech stack, how then do you how do you then take the governance stack and do a connection between the governance instruments and the quantum technology itself? So with that, I sort of found myself on this World Economic Forum program, which was how I met Moritz. And some of you may have had the privilege of being on some of these panels where you have, I think there are 50 or 100 people, and it's often very difficult to get any coherence. And the kind of thing that jumped out at me was that people are very keen on this subject. How do we govern quantum? What are the impacts of quantum? But often people would just jump in and say, well, we need to have this law about quantum, or we need this policy about quantum. And it wasn't really apparent to me that there was much clarity around how the governance architecture should work. And the kind of examples I'm talking about are, one may think, well, if we can build a fully scalable, fault-tolerant quantum computer, and people will be talking about that today, should we put constraints on its use, for example, so that people can't decrypt classically encrypted information? But if we agree that that is an ethical set of imperatives, then whose duty is that? If you're a quantum algorithm researcher, you know, is it your duty to think about that? Or is it more the duty of the director of the company or the government policy official? And what I found as part of that process was that it wasn't really clear that that the taxonomy of who should be doing what wasn't entirely clear. And so that's why I wrote this paper. So that's a lot of context. So what is this paper about? You're probably burning to know. So why quantum governance? Well, you know, again, I won't go through every possible combinatorial iteration of what QIT impact could be. Now, by QIT, I mean quantum information technologies. So I'm not talking about, say, quantum in other contexts. I'm really talking about quantum computing, quantum information processing. Now, I think we can safely assume that if a scalable, fault-tolerant quantum computer can be built. Now, again, for people that maybe don't have a background in quantum, we do not have quantum computers yet. We are far away from building a scalable, fault-tolerant quantum computer, which is the thing we need to really generate the types of potential for which people are investing. So China puts quantum at the top of its five-year plan. My PhD is partly funded by the Defense Department here. Why? Because people believe that there are significant impacts, but we are far away from building the technology. But if we do build it, it will be very significant. So we set that as a baseline assumption. And of course, as with all technologies, we need to think, well, how do we govern this new and emerging technology? And by governance as well, I think it's really important to say this. You know, I find a lot in the ethics of AI, and we see this in the debate that we saw the last few weeks over whether there should be a pause on AI. Oftentimes, I think people focus on the downsides, and as we should. We don't want ChatGPT drones coming to get us, right? But I find sometimes the downside risk may actually be totally amplified. And so I think it's really important that when we're considering risks, we think of risks as decision-making as, you know, under uncertainty. And we think about the actual building of the technology at sort of in terms of risk. You know, it is a risk that we may not build the technology. So So I think that that's key, because ultimately what we're doing with governance of any technology, but in particular quantum, is we need to trade off a series of objectives. Those are the objectives of building a quantum computer, building quantum information technologies, versus the risks, for example, that come with the wrong use of those technologies. So for this field, in this paper, I said, well, and this is a question for all tech governance, we need to answer the sui generis question. Do we need anything new? Do we need new technology governance? And the answer is yes and no. We have a lot of laws already. Probably need something like GPT-4 to really understand all the laws and governance instruments that we have. And they are very much suited already to dealing with a lot of the impacts, or a lot of the potential impacts of quantum information technologies. So one might say, why should we even bother? Why even have this conversation at all? Can't we just use existing laws? And in some sense, yes, we can, in the sense that one might just pass a law in the sort of Kantian frame that one ought to just do good. But part of the purpose of passing laws and governance and rules is to be precise about how a technology should be used. And so I think that's a strong argument about how, for example, why we may need a new set of frameworks and governance instruments to govern quantum. Just to give you context, I think there are thousands of AI frameworks and governance instruments. So it's a real question as to whether do we need that kind of scale of governance for quantum. It's not entirely clear yet. So how should we think about governance of quantum? Well, what is quantum governance? Well, firstly, and again, this might sound rote and very basic for the tech governance people in the room, one needs to identify what are the objectives and the risks of quantum information technology. So the first objective is to build it. I mean, some may say we should have that debate whether we should build it at all, but I think one can assume that that is a valid objective. And in the paper, I set out a sort of pseudo-code, as it were, for trying to think about how one ought to think about governance. The next point, and this sort of comes on from the earlier talk, is, you know, it's really important, and I think of this from a jurisprudential frame, you know, if I'm giving advice to clients, that one ought to sort of really map out who are the stakeholders involved when you're considering quantum governance. So if you're in a quantum computing startup like Psi Quantum, which is partly set up by one of my supervisors, prior to sort of jumping in with your governance policies on quantum or how you might use the technology, it's really important to understand, well, what are the interests and rights and who are the subjects who may be affected, both in terms of the people that are building the technology and the people who may be impacted by the technology. Again, it sounds entirely obvious, but oftentimes when you jump into this field, I certainly have found that this basic taxonomical passing doesn't occur. So I think it's critical. And then the next thing, again, really basic, but once you've worked out who are the stakeholders, what are the sets of instruments? If your stakeholders are states and you're concerned about how to regulate the behavior of states v. states in terms of quantum, so, for example, the use of quantum computers for offensive offensive use of quantum computing, you know, as between states. What type of instrument should you use to govern that? Now, you know, obviously, one may pass a law in Congress, but really, what you're looking at are sort of international instruments. This three-step process, I suppose, is the basic framing that I was trying to articulate to the field, again, largely to my colleagues in quantum for whom this area is, you know, is not their expertise. So just quickly, I'm not sure how much time I've got, let's just run through the objectives of quantum governance. So, 4 minutes, all right, sorry, apologies. We want to build it, we want to foster quantum collaboration, and we want to build common standards and protocols. The second thing is we want to deal with risks. These are cybersecurity risks, and there are issues as well to do with asymmetric advantage risks. If only one country holds a quantum computer, that can be highly destabilizing for global order. So what types of governance should be adopted? Well, again, you know, as I've said, one needs to map out who are the stakeholders, what are the sets of instruments, what are their rights and obligations, and what are the objectives? You know, I often think about this as if you were trying to encode this problem into an objective function in code, how would you do so? I'll just quickly skip through. So here's an example of some of the, of maybe one way to think about who the stakeholders might be. So here we have on the top left states, and states govern their interactions by treaties, customary law, so on and so forth. Then we have, for example, governments sort of inside states, as it were, and they have a set of instruments by which they can implement quantum governance. And then there are sort of softer stakeholders as well, such as technical communities, private sector corporations, and so on. The process, which you can read about in the paper, again, I sort of set out pseudocode. I like to do this at work, to set out a pseudo-algorithm. One, you need to identify who are the stakeholders. The second point is really important. I think you need to engage the stakeholders. You know, oftentimes we want to just cast the 10 commandments of governance on high, but it's really important to engage with those stakeholders because it may be that your view of governance and their interests is not actually correct. You need to identify their rights, objectives, and duties. Who owes duties to who, and who has rights? And then it's really important to undertake a risk assessment, and we'll be hearing about that shortly as well, about a new tool. And then it's important to think about, to assign probabilities to those risks. Don't just say, well, we could have a quantum computer and then we have ChatGPT, which is like this super intelligence. That's not going to happen. One needs to be really critical and apply probability. Then you need to look at, what is the existing framework which could apply? Do we even need new instruments? And then, again, I won't sort of go through the rest of it, but the sort of basic public policy processes that I've set out here. And this is a process which I argue can be adopted at any stage in the governance stack. And apologies, you probably cannot read this, and I think I'm out of time now, but in this table, which is in the paper, I try to give some examples. So if your concern is how do states, so how would this pseudocode to work out how you govern quantum work? Well, you might say, well, I'm interested in how states should govern their use of quantum technologies. And you say, well, what are the objectives of states? Well, states want to develop quantum computing, for example, for offensive and defensive capabilities. What are the sets of instruments? Formal treaties. Maybe there's some informal processes as well. What are the rights and interests of states? Well, states are interested in sovereignty, jurisdiction. States have certain objectives that they want to achieve, and so what might be an example for example, a quantum cybersecurity treaty? I won't go through this whole list, but this table tries to give you a bit of an example of if you go through this process that I've articulated, then one can really parse out what quantum governance actually looks like. So in conclusion, I argue in the paper for a quantum governance stack, providing pseudocode for how you might actually go about working out what quantum governance looks like. I have gone over time. If you have any questions, I would love to chat with you further. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Elijah, for that great interdisciplinary talk. Next up is, why is quantum different and why does this matter in metrology and imaging? Please give a hand for Dr. Thomas Jöfmann from University of Vienna.
Hello, everyone. It's a great pleasure to be here. My name is Thomas. I'm from the University of Vienna. What we're doing there is we start with basic physics and then we try to come up with new tools that can then be used in the sciences. But for this talk here, I was now tasked to give you an introduction to quantum physics, to tell you about applications in metrology and microscopy, and to give a few examples from my own lab and to do all this in 15 minutes. So I thought, why not start in 1905? Okay, 1905, let me just figure out how this works. Where do I change slides? Oh, this guy? Perfect. In 1905, Einstein wrote one of his famous papers, and in this famous paper, he, after 2,000 years of discussion whether light was a particle or a wave, and finally people had settled on a wave, he conjectured, no, we have to think of light as coming in quantized packets of energy, and those are the photons that you all know. Right? And he could use this idea to explain the photoelectric effect, which you could not explain at this time. And even though, you know, this is now 120 years old quantum physics, there's still new technology that's coming out of this. And this is one of the few examples that I have from my own lab, where we tried to combine the best of electron microscopy and the best of light microscopy. What's the best of electron microscopy? It's that you can see very, very, very tiny things down to the atomic scale. What's the worst of it? It destroys everything that you look at. Okay? What's the best of light microscopy? You can look at things for hours and days. What's the worst of it? You cannot really look at really tiny things. So what we are trying to do in this scheme that we call optical near-field electron microscopy here is we shine light on a sample that we want to study, and then we use the photoelectric effect that we had on the last slide to convert this light into an electron beam that we can then image. So it would be a non-invasive tool with a spatial ray solution down to the nanometer scale. So now we had the discussion that light, you know, we all know it propagates as an electromagnetic wave, right? So it has wave behavior, but then it also has this quantized particles that make up this field. Now, what quantum physics tells us is that this is not only true for light, but also for particle, also for atoms, neutrons, molecules, all of these things that make up, you know, the chair on which you sit. Also, these supposedly behave as a wave. So in classical physics, what we would expect if you shoot a soccer ball onto a wall with two slits in it would be that those balls, you know, just land behind those two slits. In quantum physics, what we expect is this one here. So you expect to have most balls actually land in the shadow behind the slit, and then you find other balls there, and even up to here and down to here, right? So your balls will really be distributed. And it turns out this is exactly the pattern that you get when you explain the propagation of the soccer ball as a wave. So basically, it behaves as a wave, it expands, it reaches the two slits, and then each slit acts as a source of a partial wavelet. Those two wavelets can interfere, and they lead to this interference pattern. Now, when I was a student, I didn't quite trust my textbooks who said that this was true. So what I built was this tool here. And what we did in this tool is we created a molecular beam source on the lower left side. So we created a beam of molecules that would then travel through this vacuum chamber here. And at the very end of it, up here, I built a single molecule microscope that would, let me see what the beam looks like. And of course, what we did in order to test quantum physics was that we put a grating in the middle. So this molecular beam would go through the tiny little slits in this grating, and then at the back, we would see what kind of pattern we would get. And this is what you see in this little movie here, with some music from Vienna. What you can see now, and I might want to pause this. Can we pause this, Andy? Not here, maybe where we saw the pattern? Perfect, thank you. So what you see here is that each red dot here is really a single molecule that started at the source, flew through the grating, and then landed on one spot. Right? And then you repeat this 10,000 times, and then you get this pattern. And it's interesting, right? Because why does the molecule here know what all the others did, right? But that's just the description of nature that we have now. We describe the particle as a wave function. This wave function propagates as a wave, and then the amplitude of the wave tells you the probability that you will find a molecule at a certain spot. And this pattern could be, you know, explained, of course, fully explained by quantum physics. These days, this meta-wave behavior is, of course, used in many applications out there. One of them is the diffraction of electrons, of neutrons, also of X-rays. And what you see on this science mural here that we did in Vienna is the diffraction pattern that Max Perutz used to actually understand the atomic architecture of hemoglobin. That's the molecule that transports the oxygen in our blood, right? So this is only one of the applications out there, which is, of course, hugely important in the life sciences and in medicine. Another application that I put down here is one from Stanford here, from the group of Mark Kasevich, in which I worked during my postdocs. He is using interferometry of an atomic beam to measure accelerations. So what he does is he takes an atomic beam and he splits it up, and then one part of the wave function is up here, and the other part of the wave function is down here. And this is really to scale now, because they're distant from each other by half a meter, okay? And then they recombine again, they interfere, they give you an interference pattern, and this interference pattern will depend on the accelerations those two wave functions experienced on their path, right? And this can, for example, be used for inertial navigation in submarines and so on. So it's really something useful. Of course, there are many things that are useful. I just wanted to point this one out. Electron microscopy is the next thing. You know, these days, the electron microscopes that we have are really so good that we can see the atomic structure of the machinery that is inside of our body and the arrangement of all the proteins and you know, pore complexes and ribosomes and so on. We can see all this. Why? Because an electron wave travels through the sample that we study. The sample shifts the wavefront a little bit. We can detect this, and this allows us now to really see biological matter on the atomic scale. Another example from my lab, I will keep it short. Here we used light to shape an electron beam, and we could shape the electron beam, for example, into a smiley, or we could make an electron lens made just from light. So this is just a new technology now that allows us to map the level of control that we have over light onto the level of control that we have over electrons these days. Okay, the third property of quantum physics that I wanted to discuss with you. If you have a potential landscape, or let's say you have mountains and valleys, right? I come from the Alps, so for me this is always mountains and valleys here, and you have a soccer ball, and then you let it loose, then what the soccer ball will do is it will just travel back and forth, right? But it will always stay in the left valley here. If you do the same thing in quantum physics, so you again have a potential landscape, and you again have an atom or something that you let loose in it, then you cannot watch it, right? But you can let it go, and then what will happen is the particle will behave as a wave. These waves go anywhere, and they interfere with each other, and you know the math is really hard, but you can still do it. And then at some final point in time, you can measure it, and you can ask, where is this soccer ball now? Where is the atom? Where has it gone? Okay, and most of the time what will happen is that you find it in this left valley. But then sometimes it can happen that you find it in the right valley. So now the electron has, so to say, gone from one valley to the other one, except even though the energy of it is not enough to actually overcome the potential barrier that's in between the two, to overcome the hill that's in between those two valleys, right? And this is called quantum tunneling, and is also, you know, very counterintuitive, but it all makes sense. We have measured it in the lab, it works, and these days it's used for microscopy a lot because you actually get an exponential dependence on the probability to find it in the right valley on the potential height and width. And this is used, for example, in scanning tunneling microscopy, where you take a tip, you put it close to a substrate, and then you raster over it, and you measure the tunneling current, so the electrons that jump from the substrate to the tip. And this also gives you a microscopy technique with atomic sensitivity. And here's a movie that was done by IBM. And Andrew, could you please play it? And here you can really see, and please forward a bit, yes. Here you can really see that they can not only image single atoms on a substrate, but they can also make them move. And in this way, they made this stop motion picture, you know, on the atomic scale, where a boy is playing with a soccer ball. So just another example of quantum technology can do. The last topic that I want to cover is entanglement. We've heard about it already. This is Mr. Bertelmann. Mr. Bertelmann is also a professor of physics, also from Vienna, but in the 80s he worked with John Bell. And what John Bell noticed is that Mr. Bertelmann always wore socks of two different colors, right? And so when he would see Mr. Bell come by like this, he would see the left foot first, right? And if there was a pink sock on the left foot, he would know immediately that the right sock was not pink. Okay? My socks have the same color, don't look. I'm not Mr. Bertelmann. But so basically, there's a correlation between the color of the left sock and the one on the right sock. If the left is pink, the right one is not pink. Now, in quantum physics, we have entanglement. And entanglement is also a sort of correlation between two particles. For example, what you can have, this black box that you see is a crystal, and when you shine in with blue light, it can happen that two red photons come out. And those two red photons that come out, they are entangled, right? For example, they can be entangled in their polarization degree of freedom. For example, if the first one has a horizontal polarization, then the other one will have the vertical one and the other way around. But these correlations now from quantum physics, they are stronger than those in between the two socks. Because in between the two socks, the sock that he had on the left foot was always pink, and the sock that was on the right foot was always not pink. But here it's not the case. Here the two are in an entangled state, and only when you measure one of them, suddenly both are in the final state. One pink, one not pink. But before that, it's not clear which one is which, and there's no way to find out. And only when you measure it, you set it. So the only information before you measure is that the two are in an entangled state, and you can say nothing about the subsystem. Okay, so these correlations are much, much stronger than those between Bertelmann socks. And this is, of course, also used in technology now. For example, one thing in microscopy that is used is that when you have the photons in a so-called noon state, so a noon state means that either all photons are here and none are there, or all photons are here and none are there, if you have this so-called noon state, then you can measure more sensitive. So you can measure phase shifts, you can measure birefringence in a better way. The other example this is not from my lab now, these two examples here, but I still wanted to bring them up because I find they're super cool. This second one here, quantum imaging with undetected photons. So here you have an object that you want to study that's here in the red path, so you shine red light through it, but then what you detect is the yellow light back here. So you detect yellow light that was entangled with the red light, but that had never seen the sample that you want to image, and still, in this yellow light, you can see an image of the object that you had put into the red arm, right? And this is, on the one hand, mind-blowing, but on the other hand, also useful, because, for example, for certain wavelengths, you might not have the detectors that you need to make an image, but for the yellow ones, you might have it, right? And this is also a scheme that many groups are working on now. The last slide that I have is now one that might be interesting for many of you. This is a colleague of mine, Mario Krenn. And in his PhD thesis, he was tasked to come up with a state where three photons, so three particles of light, are entangled in a very certain way. and they didn't know how to make this state in the lab. They knew if they can make this state, they can do, you know, groundbreaking physics, blah, blah, blah. But they didn't know how to make this state. And they thought about it for months and months, and they couldn't come up with it. So what Mario then did, he built a little machine learning tool that was just built in such a way that it would create some arbitrary quantum experiment, and then he would look at the outcome. And then from that, it would learn, and it would create new experiments, and new experiments, and new experiments, all, of course, on computers, right? So not in a lab. But after only one single day, this machine learning tool came up with an experimentally feasible way to create this state that they had looked for, right? And they then also showed that this, you know, this is the tool the computer came up with. In hindsight, Mario Krenn and others could actually learn from this sketch how it actually works, right? So now it's really the quantum physicists who learned from the outcome of the computer how they can make a certain quantum mechanical operation. And I think it's quite interesting, maybe also for some of you guys, because who owns the IP on this? Is it the person who tasked the AI? Is it the AI? Is it the person who wrote the machine learning code? I really don't know. What Mario now started is that he put the AI on the author list of his papers. It's AI Melvin, that's what they called it. The AI also has the honor here to be on a paper with the Nobel Prize winner from last year. So, you know, he's only a few years old, but he's doing great work already. And with this, I would like to thank you, and of course also my group and also those who give us funding. We do lots of work on electrons and on light, and if you're interested in those topics, please reach out to me in the next few hours. Thank you.
But I'm very interested in your last point. The use of AI, was it to solve a finite search problem? Essentially, it was a combinatorial problem that was hard to solve, and that's...
Exactly.
So that's what I wanted to clarify. It was not some... Yeah. Intelligence out of the box was the way it is used for saying playing Go or chess. It's a finite combinatorial problem, and AI does it better.
Yes, exactly. So basically, you know, experimental quantum physicists are not that clever. That's why they became experimentalists and not theoreticians, right? So basically, we only play with lasers, mirrors, beam splitters, polarizers. So there's a finite set of tools that we use. And the AI basically combined them in new ways and did this very, very fast and thereby could learn faster than we could. Yeah. Other questions? Otherwise. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, Thomas. That was amazing. We have a short break with a musical interlude, so we have coffee and drinks outside. Thank you so much. See you back in 10 minutes.